okay, it's not in the way of anything. Okay? Make it louder. How about that?
Good.
Get out of the way.
All right, so. Okay, well, oh, my mother said I never needed this. we'd like to welcome today David Johnson. He's here as the director of the Burrowing Owl project. And he comes to us with a bachelor's degree in biology and archaeology and a master's in wildlife science. And the Burrowing Owl project is actually doing a study that's been 12 years in the making and will end in 2022. So we're hoping that he's going to come back and tell us the results of that study. And thank you so much for coming out today.
I lead the Global Owl Project. The project has about 450 people that work with me in 66 countries. And so as part of this presentation, I'm going to start talking a little bit about the Owl Project and then into jumping to the Burrowing Owl Project. So I want to talk a little bit about fossils as well, fossil burrowing owls specifically. So the Global Owl Project, I've been working with owls for 46 years now. And so in 2001, the National Science Foundation put out a request for proposals under their planetary biodiversity inventory program. They said, if we discovered life on a new planet, we would want to inventory it. Well, we haven't done such a great job over here. So they wanted global scale inventories for particular taxa. So myself and 13 other people put together a proposal for the Global Owl Project. Now we got started with that. So our focus is on the science, the foundational science, and conservation of owls. The regular folks, just like you and me, all around the world, 56 countries. Upper left here, we have folks in the Rainbow Island, the roughly far east. Upper right is folks from Mongolia. One of my interns here in the lower left, one from Burrowing Owl, and a guy, Chuck from Malaysia. But you get the idea, caring, talented, passionate people, just like you. There's seven tasks of the Global Owl Project. The first one is on survey and monitoring techniques. How do we find owls? How do you survey for them? How do you monitor populations? The second one is on getting genetic samples of all the owls in the world. So we identify species and understand the conservation implications. Number three is, owls do not learn their calls. They're all genetically inherited. If you had an owl egg and you raised it, and incubated it, raised it with a parakeet song all the time, or a song carol or something, when it got to be adult, it would only sing owl. So they don't learn their calls, they're genetically inherited. So getting vocalization is important because we can identify species by their calls. Number four is the physical descriptions of owls. We're still finding new owls to science. And so part of our effort is focused on all the physical descriptions of the owls in the world, including all the original descriptions as when they were first reported to science. Number five is on distribution maps for conservation planning. We've got to have good maps. Okay. Number six is owls and myth and culture. What people believe about owls makes a difference in how they conserve and protect owls. So what do people really believe? Okay? There's lots of stories and lots of myths. So what do people really believe? So we developed an interview form and we interviewed 6,000 people in 30 countries. It's the same interview form in 22 different languages. And it's fascinating. It's from A to Z, the beliefs and understandings. And so, and then now we're learning about how cultures change. We kill people for being witches in Salem, Massachusetts. And now Halloween, we dress up as witches. So society's changed. And they're all over these things. And the seventh is just simply giving away all this information for free. It's not about us, it's about conservation of the planet. And so all of the scientific publications and information we want to get out there so people can actually use it. There are currently 257 living owl species in the world. put together a map of 255. There are two species that don't have maps yet. We have genetic samples, we know the specific one. So 257 is the number to look. And there's about 30 other owl species that are other owl taxa that are in the review process. There's going to be more. I want to jump back into the fossil record a bit. This is not an owl wing. This is a bird about the size of a cat bird. Okay. But it's 98.8 million years old. This is a feathered wing. It was found in amber. Okay. But the point of it is that birds have evolved a long time ago. Birds have had feathers for a very long time. At that point in time, the continents were still connected, or mostly connected. And so imagine then, I think not far from that, owls evolved. Okay? And so some of the owls, they're all around the world, like the previous map showed. Well, how did they get there? Well, I think just if you think back far enough, there was connections where they could have been more easily distributed around the world. But not like the current versions of owls, but predecessors. We know there's some owls that were definitely owls 56 million years ago. And there's some evidence now that thinking that right about the time when the meteorite struck the Earth, there was already owls. And so we just haven't found the fossils yet. Well, they're bird fossils, they don't fossilize well. Owls don't just fall in the mud very easy. But anyway, this was a small owl, the size of a burrowing owl. Here's an owl pellet, 48 million years old. Okay? So there's got to be owls that make pellets, right? Anyway, you get the idea that there's evidence to support that there were owls a long time ago. The biggest owl that ever roamed the earth was this one. It was a little over a meter tall, 50 tall, 39 inches, 40 inches tall. And so people ask me, David, what do you think it ate? I think it ate anything it wanted to. I was found in Cuba. So there's lots of variety. It's extinct now. Some of the features that make owls owls. They've had a long time to evolve, and they need the sign of flight. So one of the ways to do that is this is the serrated leading edge of the feather, okay, or the flight feather. And so this helps ease the wind over their wing. Okay? It breaks up the eddies. It's called Penola. This white velvety, this is a barn owl feather. And it's a white velvety substance here. And it acts both as a silencer, but it also keeps the feathers from rubbing each other when the bird's flapping. Because the feathers just what? They continually do this. And when you hear a crow fly over, you hear the flap, 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 flap. But when owls fly over, you don't hear that. Well, one of the reasons why is because of this panel. Okay? It spaces the feathers. And it silences them too. And the trailing edge of the feathers also break up the eddies. So I want to talk just a moment about the dark spots and the light spot, the adjacent ones. When you took a sample of this dark spot and the light spot, you find out that the dark spot is about 5% heavier than the light spot. It's because it has three different chemicals in it that are not found in the light spots. And those chemicals make that feather heavier in that spot. But what you should think of is, this is not camouflage, this is structure. Like the Wright brothers' plane, you have structure, struts, and then skin in between. So, here's your structure, and here's the lightweight stuff in between. So the owls have evolved with putting the structure where they need it to get a strong feather, but not putting all that energy into places where they don't need it. So, all sorts of fascinating things about owls. Here is the Athene, and you saw the costume person, the Athene? Yeah, wonderful. That's really wonderful. And so, this is the Burrowing Owl family. Okay? And so, these are bones 5.3 to 3.6 million years old, found in South Africa. Okay, very much like a burrowing owl. So here we are. This is another burrowing owl type, an early version of it. It's more a little bit bigger, about 10% bigger than our current burrowing owls. It's extinct, but it was in Kansas and Idaho. And so when it says Upper Pliocene, that's a geologic time in history, 3.48 million years ago, plus or minus. And so MA means millions of years ago. So 3.48 means 3,480,000 years ago.
Okay.
So we had burrowing owls then in Idaho, Kansas. And after that, we found some owls that were the same. Burrowing owls existed like they are now. And that's called the recent. Okay. Athene cunicularia, burrowing owl. So back here, it's maybe as old as 5 million years. So the burrowing owls have been along around a really long time. Okay. So they've also been found in the La Brea Parkets. So there are actually 22 subspecies described of the burrowing owls. Two of them are already extinct. One from Guadalupe Island in the Caribbean, another one from St. Kitts and Nevis. So there's 18 here, and it depends whose list you use or how many owls there are, burrowing owls there really are. They're different systems. So we're going through now and doing a taxonomic review of all of these to say, really, we found that the one in Aruba actually sounds quite different than the other burrowing owl that you had here in Florida. And so, is it a different species? Let's find out. How do you find out? DNA samples, vocalizations, morphology, geographic distribution. You get those four things, you got it. You can sort that out then. So we're doing that for all of these so that you can actually figure out. There may be another one that'll rise to a full species status. Here's a distribution in the Americas. It's only growing out, only found in North Central South America. But they're quite well distributed. Well, if you had 5 million years, you could kind of separate out yourself. Huh? So, they're quite far apart, and they evolved to be separate now. The upper is a female, the lower is a male. Well, how can you tell? Things to look for is this white eyebrow and this big white chin strap. And this guy, during the mid-breeding season or later, they molt in October, September, October, go by now and later. They're going to, the male will start to bleach out because they really light from the sun. Because he stands outside most of the time. He'll get light. She'll be dark because she's in the burrow. So as the summer progresses, the males will get lighter and the females will remain dark. Then in summer, late summer, fall, they'll molt and then they'll kind of look alike again. That's for that amount of white. And behavior. So burrowing owls are the only species that really nest in burrows. Barn owls nest in holes or caves. But burrowing owls nest in burrows, some that they make themselves, of course. But most of the burrowing owls nest in holes made by other animals. So the burrowing owls are one of the only species of owls, all of them, that make their own nest. Okay? The great horned owls, they never make their own nest. They don't collect sticks, none of that. So otherwise, the burrowing owls will enlarge a cavity or actually make a cavity, because many of you probably have starter burrows. Yeah, you know. So anyway, badger, prairie dog, ground squirrel, gopher tortoise or desert tortoise, big one. Hit boxes, whoever makes holes. Growing owls everywhere really like open habitats. I need to stress that because they evolved with grass and shrub step environments. This is in Washington State, where I started here. This is in Oregon. This is a shrub step environment. And so one of our owls here, I put a transmitter on this bird, and there's this youngsters, and we tracked her back and forth to California for 3 years, every winter. Then I took the transmitter off. So other places we find them, this is in Aruba, but it can be even around here, burrow in the by a parking lot. This is from people yard near some construction.
Yeah.
Okay. This is in Aruba again, but it happens a few times in Florida, but I've not seen it anywhere else. Where the owls will actually burrow into a dirt pile that was meant for a construction project. They didn't quite get in there in time and so forth. So we talked this landowner into putting up a fence to protect the owls from dogs and cats. And so they nested successfully and they loved it and so forth. And then they said, we're going to hold off on a project because we're not sure that we wanted to do what we did. Well, then they nested there a second year. Okay? So this is desperation housing. this tells you that nest burrows are really limited, and it's really a sign of true desperation. Here's a place in Arizona. So this is not where owls live, this is where owls die. Okay. And they nested underneath the sidewalk, but if you find right then, it's fast moving traffic, they don't have a chance. But they'll try. They try. Here's a male that was not altogether friendly with me. Because I put this little geolocator on it. It weighs about as much as a dime. It's a little backpack. Okay. So I track the migration. It's called a geolocator and it uses available sunlight to track the time and the movements of the owls. You have to recapture and then take it off to get the data off it. It only records. Well, what? Guess what? This was in Oregon, on my study area in North Central Oregon. The red lines are females here, okay? The blue lines are males. Then you'll see all of the females went south to California for the winter, all right? Some of the males went south. Those were the young males, okay? The old males went north. I couldn't believe it. I thought something was wrong with the data. So they went north into Washington. And then I realized why. Why would they do that? They're tough guys. They're adult males. They know how to hunt because they just hunted for the whole family. So they can certainly provide for themselves. There's no insects, so they have to catch small animals. So they can do that. If they stay up there and risk the winter, cold and snow, they get to be first back. The breeding grounds. If you're first back at the breeding grounds, you get dibs. You get dibs on the best burrow, on the best territory. If you get the best burrow in the best territory, you're going to get the best burrow, and you're going to be most successful in having youngsters. Okay? The females, why would I want to risk going north? I can go south, I can have a calm, casual winter, I can put some weight on, I'll be in perfect shape to come back, lay eggs, incubate, brood the youngsters, as long as I made the right choice on the males. Okay. So what we find, and you'll find this here, is that females will pick the male that's going to be a good provider. Okay. If they're successful, I'll stay with you. If I'm not successful, why the heck would I want to stay with you? Okay. Alright, yeah, the sun is starting to sound familiar, huh? So the males, everything is in that burrow. Their whole life, if they don't have a burrow, they've got nothing. Alright? So they'll protect and guard and defend that burrow. And so the burrows in your lawns and so forth are premium quality. Everything is tied up in it. Okay, for the males. It's in other places as well. They see a few of those in Brazil. And so think of it as a subdominant genetic trait. Yeah. So the answer basically is no, not very many other places. They're all yellow.
I just want to say, if anyone in the room is interested in having a burrow in your front yard, okay, a starter burrow, you can sign up at the Wildlife Trust table. We have an application you have to fill out to make sure your yard is appropriate. We're also giving prizes to five people who sign up and who qualify for a starter burrow. And you can see a starter burrow demonstration right here at the park. So we already had 10 people sign up. sign up, so I'm sure there's some people in this room that would be interested in having owls in their front yard.
My mom wants one in her front yard. She lives in Minnesota. Sometimes they have to be relocated. Is it difficult to relocate them? And the answer is, it's getting easier because we are understanding more about how to do it. Okay, so there are translocation programs, and I'm advisor on 8 such programs: British Columbia, Manitoba, a couple in California, Arizona, Florida. Here, there's a couple in Florida, Aruba, and Brazil. So it goes something like this. Here's, like I mentioned, the male is so invested in that site that when you catch him, if you were just to take him over to point B and release him, hard release, he'll beat you back. You know, because everything he's got is invested in this place. He knows it like the back of his dad's hand. So what we do is we take them, put them in a soft release cage, feed them, and hold them for 30 days to break the bond to that old site. Now he's in a new place, he's getting familiar with it, all right? But he doesn't have a territory, he doesn't know how to hunt it, he hasn't memorized this new place yet, so you have to give him time. The female, the reason she was with him was because he was a good provider on that site. Oh, she goes to the new site, come on, Bob, come get with the program. And so he's got to learn to hunt that and become a good provider. Put in the artificial girls, they got that part covered. But you can see the challenges for how the ecology doesn't fit with quick, just move over there, we'll be fine. That's not quite how it goes. So we can give them as good or a better place, okay? That's a key thing. A good habitat to move them into. Alright? So then they will stay, if they do stay. We move them in sync with the wild ones. So when the wild ones are dispersing, the fall shuffle, the winter movements, the early spring shuffle and courtship, so that we release them so that it's that time. So that's a normal sequence for them, right? Rather than we're going to move them in July because that's the time you need to move them. Well, you're just putting them at a pretty big disadvantage. That's not when they normally do that anyway. So if the timing with the ecology, if the place all of a sudden starts to put the pieces in place to make that work. Because we really want them to be successful, of course. Well, we can only expect them to be as successful as the wild ones are. Not all 100% are going to survive, but they don't do that in the wild anyway. So we have to adjust our expectations so it hits the wild conditions. Right? So now you're starting to see it's a little more complex than just moving over there. We can do it, yes. We do it thoughtfully and carefully. And we try to keep pairs together or family groups together. But we don't want to put 2 males in the same cage because one will die. We don't put 2 females in there because they're not going to mate. So they'll be okay together. They won't fight necessarily, but that's not success. Yes, sir.
How is the population growing out over the last 3 years?
How is the population? They're declining range-wide in the Americas, I think that's fair to say. The owls in Canada have declined 94% in the last 30 years. They've crashed. So they're doing everything they can in Canada to try to protect nesting habitats. And when the owls come back and they nest, they do really well. They nest, they have a lot of youngsters. That's not where the problem is. The problem is, Mexico, when the owls migrate, there's not a lot of good habitat between Canada and Mexico across the U.S. in the plain states. So it's partly a wintering migration route. There's not good stops along the way. And then in Mexico, there's more agricultural stuff there too. So they're losing out wintering places, wintering habitat. So there are fewer birds that actually get back to Canada to nest. So the oldest owls they get in Canada are 4-year-olds. In Oregon, I get 2-year-olds. Okay. Well, if you lose that older age group of population, the good creatures and the good nesters, Aruba, we think that there's about 150 nesting pairs left on Aruba for that subspecies, so they're endangered. So it's kind of like the Florida scenario, that it's declining, then you get listed, and then what do you do? Well, that some of the issues that are still threats are still very real threats. So, yeah, it's a hard game. Okay. Oh. Her boss is here for the tour. I got to hand over the mic. Okay, now I get to do this freehand.
I'm sure.
In other places as well. They see a few of those in Brazil. Okay. And so think of it as a subdominant genetic trait. Yeah. So the answer basically is no, not very many other places. They're all yellow.
I just want to say, if anyone in the room is interested in having a burrow in your front yard, okay, a starter burrow, you can sign up at the Wildlife Trust table. We have an application you have to fill out to make sure your yard is appropriate. We're also giving prizes to five people who sign up and who qualify for a starter burrow. And you can see a starter burrow demonstration right here at the park. So we already had 10 people sign up, so I'm sure there's some people in this room that would be interested in having owls in their front yard.
My mom wants one in her front yard. She lives in Minnesota. Sometimes they have to be relocated. Is it difficult to relocate them? And the answer is, it's getting easier because we are understanding more about how to do it. Okay. So there are translocation programs, and I'm advisor on 8 such programs: British Columbia, Manitoba, a couple in California, Arizona, Florida. Here, there's a couple in Florida, Aruba, and Brazil. So it goes something like this. Here's, like I mentioned, the male is so invested in that site that when you catch him, if he were just taken over to point B and release him, hard release, he'll beat you back. You know, because everything he's got is invested in this place. He knows it like the back of his dad's hand. So what we do is we take them, put them in a soft release cage, feed them, and hold them for 30 days to break the bond to that old site. So, now he's in a new place, he's getting familiar with it, all right? But he doesn't have a territory, he doesn't know how to hunt it, he hasn't memorized this new place yet, so you have to give him time. The female, the reason she was with him was because he was a good provider on that site. Oh, she goes to the new site, come on, Bob, get with the program. So, he's got to learn to hunt that and become a good provider. Put in the artificial burrows, they got that part covered. But you can see the challenges for how the ecology doesn't fit with quick, just move them over there, we'll be fine. That's not quite how it goes. So we can give them as good or a better place, okay? That's a key thing. A good habitat to move them into, all right? And so then they will stay, if they do stay. We move them in sync with the wild ones. So when the wild ones are dispersing, the fall shuffle, the winter movements, early spring shuffle and courtship, so that we release them so that it's that time. So that's a normal sequence for them, right? Rather than making, we're going to move them in July because that's when we need to move them. Well, you're just putting them at a pretty big disadvantage. It doesn't really, that's not when they normally do that anyway. So, if the timing with the ecology, if the place all of a sudden starts to put pieces in place to make that work. We want them to be successful, of course. Well, we can only expect them to be as successful as the wild ones are. Not all 100% are going to survive, but they don't do that in the wild anyway. So we have to adjust our expectations so that it fits the wild conditions. Right? So now you're starting to see it's a little more complex than just moving over there. We can do it, yes. We do it thoughtfully and carefully. And we try to keep pairs together or family groups together. And so, but we don't want to put two males in the same cage because one will die. We don't put two females in there because they're not going to mate. So they'll be okay together. They won't fight necessarily. But that's not a success. So, yeah?
Yes.
Okay, yes, sir.
How has the population of burrowing owls over the last 30 years?
How is the population? They're declining range-wide in the Americas, that's fair to say. The owls in Canada have declined 94% in the last 30 years. They've crashed. So they're doing everything they can in Canada to try to protect nesting habitats. And when the owls come back and they nest, they do really well. They nest, they have a lot of youngsters. That's not where the problem is. The problem is Mexico, when the owls migrate, there's not a lot of good habitat between Canada and Mexico across the U.S. that used to be the plain state. So it's partly a wintering migration route. There's not good stops along the way. And then in Mexico, there's more agricultural stuff there too. So they're losing out wintering places, wintering habitat. So there are fewer birds that actually get back to Canada to nest. So the oldest owls I get in Canada are four-year-olds. In Oregon, I get two-year-olds. Okay. Well, if you lose that older age group of population, the good breeders and the good nesters, Aruba, we think that there's about 150 nesting pairs left on Aruba, so that subspecies, so they're endangered. So it's kind of like the Florida scenario, that it's declining, then you get listed, and then what do you do? Well, then some of the issues that are still threats are still very real threats. So, yeah, then it's a hard game. Yes. Her bus is here for the tour. I got to hand over the mic. Okay, now I can do this.